Hello, and welcome to ADHD Support Talk Radio. This is your host, Tara McGillicuddy. I am an adult ADD and ADHD productivity coach. I am also the founder and director of addclasses.com. And at addclasses.com, we provide virtual support to people affected by ADD in an extensive ADD audio library with more than 150 courses. And we also offer more in-depth support programs. You can learn more about addclasses.com by going to the website, www.addclasses.com. And with that, I would like to welcome back Dr. Roberto Olivardia to ADHD Support Talk. In just a moment, we're going to be talking about sleep and ADHD. But before we begin the discussion, Dr. Olivardia, can you let our listeners know a bit about yourself and how they get in touch with you?
Sure. It's always great to be here, Tara. I am a clinical instructor in the Department of Psychiatry at Harvard Medical School in Boston and a clinical psychologist. I have a private practice in a suburb of Boston, Lexington, Mass., where I specialize in the treatment of ADHD as well as individuals with obsessive-compulsive disorder and eating disorders and body image issues. And people can feel free to email me. I do not have a Facebook or Twitter account or page, so email would be the best way. And that is Roberto, R-O-B-E-R-T-O, underscore Olivardia, which is O-L-I-V-A-R-D-I-A, at HMS, like Harry, Mary, Sally, .harvard.edu.
Okay, great. So we're going to be talking about sleep today. And I had you on years ago to talk about sleep. You have a class in the ADD audio library about sleep. But it's such a huge and a very common issue for people with ADHD. So I thought it made sense to have you again to talk about it. So I guess the question is, how common are sleep problems for people with ADD and ADHD?
Oh, it's so common. And I find, too, what's interesting about this topic is that when I give talks about this, it is probably one of the biggest issues that I hear from people with ADHD, parents who have children with ADHD. It's more the exception that somebody with ADHD does not have a problem with sleep. We see everything from trouble falling asleep, multiple times getting up, trouble waking up, trouble maintaining vigilance, almost like a sort of narcoleptic state during the day, sleep apnea, narcolepsy, circadian rhythm abnormalities. There is without a doubt, and there is a substantial body of research that looks at this that has found that people with ADHD are without a doubt more prone to various sleep problems. And I'm speaking as a professional, but I'm also speaking as someone with ADHD who has a bevy of those sleep problems and disorders himself. So I'm very well aware of the difficulty that something that is so basic to a lot of people, just going to sleep every night, is very effortful.
Mm-hmm. Well, what are some of the reasons that sleeping can be such a challenge and there are so many sleep issues with ADHD?
Well, one of them is biological, which I actually found very validating when I delved into the scientific research and looked at that there are ways that the ADHD brain is wired that actually lends itself to that. So, for example, melatonin, which you may have heard is a hormone that our brain secretes, that when we have high levels of melatonin, our body starts to feel tired, and it's sort of a signal that we are about to go to sleep. And studies show, actually, that the ADHD brains don't seem to get that sort of flood of melatonin, or at least it doesn't seem to get it at a time when everybody else might be at like 10 or 11 o'clock at night. That some people with ADHD actually have what's called a delayed sleep phase syndrome, so a DSPS, delayed sleep phase syndrome, in which their circadian rhythms, which are in a sense basically the brain waves of our brain that regulate sleep, that actually show that they're on this kind of other cycle. So instead of starting to want to fall asleep at 10 or 11 o'clock, the brain might actually be waking up at that time and then wanting to go to sleep at about 2 a.m., and that's where the melatonin levels are starting to kind of kick in. And I have had a sleep study, and I actually have this delayed sleep phase syndrome, which was very validating because it is really difficult for me to go to bed before midnight. I do it sometimes, but I recognize that it is going to be harder than somebody who doesn't have that. We have also seen in sleep, we have stage 1, 2, 3, 4, and then REM sleep where we dream. And that's really where we often get the restorative feeling with sleep. And studies show that for whatever reason, we don't 100% know why, that people with ADHD tend to either have shorter REM cycles. Some people don't even hit. I had a patient who had he would sleep 8 hours a night, but have all the symptoms of sleep deprivation, and we had ruled out sleep apnea and other, and it turns out when he had a sleep study that he was never entering REM sleep, that he hit stage 1, 2, 3, 4, and for whatever reason was skipping REM sleep, and so he never got that restorative feeling that's associated with sleep, although he was technically sleeping. So there's a lot of research that's starting to be done on that. So there is a biological component, but there's also a behavioral and environmental component. People with ADHD tend to engage in habits that often will promote the sleep deprivation. So because a lot of people, either because they tend to be night owls or because those of us with ADHD are drawn towards stimulating activities, we often can engage in activities that probably are not the best things to do when we want our minds to quiet down. And now with the technology that we have, which is something that, you know, we can almost look historically and we see this enormous jump that occurs really with the advent of the internet and iPads and all of that in the whole field of sleep medicine, that sleep doctors absolutely can point to the influence of technology. And there are really interesting studies that have been done that look at the effect of what they call blue light, which is the light that is emitted from an iPad or a computer, which is even different than what you get from a television, that actually show disruptions in melatonin levels. For example, there was a study that was done where it looked at individuals who read a book from their iPad or Kindle versus those that read a regular printed book. And both groups got 8 hours of sleep after reading for the same amount of time. So they're sleeping the same amount of time, they're reading the same amount of time. However, the people who read from the mobile device the next day reported feeling more sleepy. They felt more tired overall, and when sleep studies were done, they actually had shorter REM cycles than the people who, and this was not people who had shorter REM cycles to begin with. They were randomly assigned to these groups, and so there was something about the emission of that light that wires the brain in a way that's basically waking it up at a time when you really want you to go to bed. So one of the tips I would give people with ADHD who might want to read before going to sleep, read from an actual book. It really makes a difference. Studies also show that even the difference between when we look at an iPad or a mobile device, we're typically looking at it no more than a foot away from our eyes. I mean, a lot of people, it could be like 6 inches from their face. Very different than how we even watch television. When we're watching television, we're typically watching it feet away. That actually makes a difference. That studies show that even the distance of that blue light can make a big difference in how one sleeps that night. So it's very important, and what we're seeing too with just young people in general, but especially because people with ADHD are drawn to this kind of, you know, technology and the stimulating effects of video games and YouTube and all of that, it's sort of a double whammy that we have to really pay attention to.
And it depends what people are doing on their computers and gadgets and stuff too. If you're answering an email that you're upset about, that's going to wake your brain up too. So there's so much that plays into this when it comes to sleep, the biology, the environment, you know, the technology, but what you're actually doing with the technology. And I don't think a lot of people have really thought that through or even aware of it. So I'm so glad you're bringing this up today.
Absolutely. I mean, when we engage in answering an email, it's bringing up sort of what the context of that email is about. Even if it's a quick work thing, our brains could now make associations of, oh, okay, even though this might be a simple email I'm responding to, that might start a whole bevy of thoughts that now I'm thinking about, when that's the last thing I want to do. Like, that's already what I find for me personally and a lot of my patients is it's so tough to fall asleep because the mind is just so active and thinking about things. And sometimes it's things that I'm anxious about, and sometimes it's things that I'm excited about, and sometimes it's just random thoughts that I have to really pay attention to just focus on falling asleep. It's very, very effortful. But absolutely, all of those tasks that we might, and see, and part of it too is even if you backtrack before the nighttime, many of us with ADHD procrastinate and really struggle with procrastination. That feeds into sleep deprivation because if, let's say, you're supposed to be getting something done at 2 in the afternoon and you're putting it off, you're putting it off, you're putting it off, and it's due at 9 a.m. the next morning and you put it off until midnight, well, guess what? Now it's affecting your sleep. And now you're stressed, which now your body is filled with adrenaline and cortisol, these stress hormones that really are designed to not have you fall asleep because those hormones are designed to basically help you in a threatening situation. Like if there was a tiger running after you, your body is not going to want to sleep when a tiger is running after you. Your body is going to go into a flight or fight mode. It's going to either want to kill that tiger or run as fast away from it. So all your energy is going now to your arms and legs. So when we're in periods of stress and procrastination, that causes stress. Even when people are in that hyper-focused zone, and this is something that took me years to really understand, if you ask me if I'm stressed during some of those hyper-focused periods, I would say no. Like, this is great. Like, I feel like I'm just going down a water slide. Like, this is – but my body is stressed. And I learned that because after these periods of extreme productivity where I would get these amazing things done and I would feel awesome and happy, I would then end up with shingles or mononucleosis.
Oh, my God.
You know, oh, yeah. I thought only people in their 80s got shingles. Well, that's not true. That if you stress your body enough, your body, and that's what I learned, is that my body was stressed, even though I subjectively wouldn't call it that because I was so focused on getting whatever I left for the last minute done. And of course, my sleep is going to be completely now disrupted because even if I'm going to bed at 1, 2 in the morning, now my body's jacked up with cortisol and adrenaline. How am I really going to have a full quality deep sleep? And this is a common daily experience for many people with ADHD.
Now, what does poor sleep, you know, do to ADHD symptoms? I know lack of sleep just for the general population really has negative effects, but what does it do specifically for the ADHD and the symptoms?
Absolutely. That if you think about all of the sleep deprivation symptoms that affect the general population, you want to exponentially increase them for people with ADHD. It's already hard for people with ADHD to, let's say, the student to sit in class for 5 hours, 6 hours a day. That's going to be not even doubly, but exponentially harder if they don't get a good night's sleep. It will your focus, your concentration, your ability to regulate emotions. Again, like all of the things that would affect everybody, but it's just going to be that much more effective to someone or will affect people more with ADHD. So all of us might get a little irritable if we haven't had a good night's sleep. For the person with ADHD who already might have some emotional regulation issues, it can get they can get explosive. And I've had patients where it's very clear we see that correlation when they're not sleeping well, that they're much more irritable, they're getting in more conflicts with their spouses or family members. Also, sleep deprivation is a contributing factor to obesity in this country. I do when I talk about eating and obesity in relation to ADHD, when we don't sleep, our appetite gets totally dysregulated and hormones start kicking in our bodies that actually have us store body fat and crave carbohydrates and fat and sugar. So it's like a double whammy there. And then, of course, the more carbs and sugars we eat, that's not good for our energy and our attention. There are studies looking at driving that already for people with ADHD tend to be more likely to get into car accidents and to be reckless drivers if you're sleep deprived, it's even worse. It really is one of those things that is so important, and it seems so basic, and it is, you know, it is a basic drive. We need to sleep, but it absolutely exacerbates. And one of the myths that a lot of my patients think is, if they're, let's say, taking a medication, for my the patients of mine who take stimulants in addition to the therapy, that they assume that, well, I'll just take my Adderall. Well, Adderall, Ritalin, they don't counteract sleep deprivation. I mean, they're going to basically help you from the sort of state that you're in, but these medications are not meant to take the place of you sleeping. And I've seen that a lot, particularly my younger patients sometimes, who just assume, well, I'll just have an energy drink. And some of these energy drinks have literally 250 milligrams of caffeine. They're terrible. And I've seen that more and more as a trend. I mean, I didn't know, when I was in high school, I didn't know anyone who drank coffee in high school. Like, that was just something old people did. You know, nobody drank coffee. And now I work with seventh graders who are coming in with Starbucks and coming in with, like, espresso, with that 300 milligrams of caffeine espresso drinks. And I'm thinking, oh, my gosh, like, I didn't start drinking coffee till I had my first child. I mean, that it's a big problem. A lot of people are self-medicating with caffeine and then becoming literally addicted to it.
Wow. So it sounds like it's pretty darn important to improve your sleep. So what are some strategies that people can do to help improve their sleep and sleep better?
Absolutely. Well, starting with the technology, there have been research studies that show actually that even adjusting the brightness, if you want to really read your book on a Kindle or look at an iPad, and some people find that, you know, that's their part of their habit, even adjusting the brightness a little bit where it's not super bright could make a difference on your sleep.
Oh,
there
wow.
are filters actually that people can use to put on their iPad that sort of minimizes that blue light without compromising the visibility of what they're looking at on screen. And it turns out that actually makes a difference in terms of some of the sleep data that people are getting, scientists are getting in sleep studies. Or having what's called a curfew distance, which is saying to yourself, you know what, the half hour before I'm going to go to bed, I'm not going to have any technology. So it's almost like a curfew, giving yourself distance from the time you look at technology to when you go to sleep, as opposed to literally just shutting off the iPad and then trying to go to sleep. In addition, having darkness, as much darkness, even including like clocks and iPhones. My iPhone is my alarm clock, but it's always face down, so there's no light emitting from it. I need complete darkness. I have room darkening shades in my room. Often climate control. People with ADD tend to sleep better when the room is very cool and calm, and sometimes cold, with something like heavy on them, like almost like a pressure, and that's often more of a sensory thing, like having like a heavy comforter. Even in the summertime, I mean, I have air conditioning where I put it super cold and I still sleep with a comforter in the summer, because you want your body to find the bed inviting, as opposed to looking at, you know, it is like this place that you kind of don't want to be. For a lot of people, I would recommend, if you're someone who does do a lot of thinking and that keeps you up, like myself, I write my to-do list for the next day of things that I want to attend to. I have my appointment book, which I literally functions as a diary. I write everything in it. And that way it's all written out, and I kind of know, okay, I don't have to chew on this now. Right now I can focus on going to sleep, and tomorrow morning I'll wake up and I'll look at my to-do. It'll all be there. It's not like thinking about it now is going to do anything for me. So that can help sort of purging your thoughts out. For some people, chamomile tea, taking a warm bath. Now, exercise, interestingly, just even engaging in any regular exercise, whatever time of day, is best and can improve sleep efficiency. So even if you're exercising first thing in the morning, which is actually the best for your metabolic cycle, that will improve your sleep 14, 16 hours later. I work out actually in the nighttime, and for many people with ADD, people might think, oh, well, doesn't that wake you up? For me, it does the opposite. I work out at night, I come home, I take a shower, and I am just, like, my energy is just out. Like, I almost don't have the energy anymore to think about things. It really helps calm me down, and I learned that by trying to do, I mean, I'm not a morning person in general, but it, in one hand, it might be better for your metabolic cycle to work out in the morning, but at the end of the day, I found I was getting better sleep when I work out at night. So, and you don't have to go to, I mean, I go to a gym that's open 24 hours, but some people, you can do jumping jacks and sit-ups, and you can do weight-free mm-hmm. training even in your home. So that could be helpful. Sometimes, you know, if you're going to watch a television show, but don't, it's tough nowadays where we have access to binge watching TV shows.
Oh.
You want to be careful not to get into that. That really, you know, and if that's too hard, then it might just be altogether not a good thing. Maybe watching, you know, a TV show that doesn't, something that doesn't have that, like, multiple episodes that you have access to, because that's very hard for people with ADD. And being aware of also what you're eating, not to eat anything too heavy, but sometimes people do find, you know, if they have, you know, a little something, like a little snack a couple hours before bed, a fruit or something like that, that could be helpful.
Okay. Well, I'm glad you gave some strategies. Those sound like fairly easy ones. I know I wouldn't say easy. They're always easy to implement, but they're basic everyday strategies that people
exactly.
can try. Yeah. So we're actually towards the end of today's show. Do you have any final thoughts that you'd like to leave people with? And could you also give out your contact information once again?
Sure. I would say that in general is to really, really pay attention to this issue. And I think especially for younger people out there who might be listening to this, teenagers, people in their early 20s, it's very easy to kind of get away with sleep deprivation when you're younger in the ways mm-hmm. that, you know, I was someone who I could be up for 2 days straight and you would not know it. I mean, my energy, you know, I was not depressed or irritable or whatnot, but my body, like I said before, I would just come down with, like, the flu and these sort of things. Like, my body took a hit. But the sad thing is that there's a lot of data that looks at, you know, how chronic sleep deprivation is associated with cancers and things like that later in life, which is scary. And so, you know, when we're 20, we think we're invincible and in those kind of ways. So I just urge people to really, really pay attention to this. And if you really have a significant problem with sleep, that even when you incorporate these behavioral strategies, talk to your doctor, get a sleep study. I got one done, and it turned out I had severe sleep apnea alongside of the circadian rhythm abnormalities and things like that that now I can get treatment for, and that significantly helped in terms of that. So a lot of times there are these underlying sleep disorders that, again, impact your ADHD. And definitely encourage people to email me. My email is Roberto, R-O-B-E-R-T-O, _Olivardia, which is O-L-I, V as in Victor, A-R, D as in Daniel, I-A, at HMS, like Harry, Mary, Sally, .Harvard.edu.
Well, thank you so much, Dr. Roberto Olivardia, and thank you, everyone, for taking the time to listen to ADHD Support Talk Radio. Thanks again.